I'm Brian Holt, a senior product manager at Snowflake, and welcome to the complete intro to product management. I created this course because I went from being a software engineer to a product manager, and I wanted to share with you what made me effective as a product manager. In this course, we'll talk about what product management actually is, stakeholder management, communication, how to write better documents, how to run better meetings, product development, and how to plan and prioritize your roadmaps. I hope you use these skills to ship awesome products. Enjoy the course. I like determining the what of what we work on. So I saw this quite a bit at Netflix. Netflix does a really good job of getting their engineers involved early in projects where the engineer actually gets a say in like how we're going to build and what we're going to build. And I got that was really exciting to me. At Reddit, I kind of just determined everything that we were going to work on because I didn't have a PM and I also didn't have a designer. And I didn't have any. I was employee 29 at Reddit. So like that was kind of all of it all in one. But I liked that Netflix helped me, you know, in a big corporate environment, get to be able to say what we're going to work on. I've been the code monkey before where they basically say like, all right, code monkey, go do that, right? And that was fun. Like, it's fun too because I like writing code. I just enjoyed the act of writing code. But I also got really into like, what are we going to build? Why are we building this? Who are we going to build it for? One of my favorite experiences at Netflix is how much UX research we got to do. And I actually got to go watch people use my product. And then we got to adjust our product based on customer feedback. And I was like, this is like, I really like this, right? And so that's one part about being a PM that I like is like, now I get to call the shots. Like for the most part, like I am the product owner of my organization and I get to tell, all right, it's not like I get to dictate to them, like, you must do this, but like I get to organize everything and I get to insert my opinions and my own flavor and my own strategy on all of that. And that's my favorite part of being a PM. This is the determining the what. It is people. Like, so you get to, that's going to get distracting. So I'm going to scroll up a little bit. It's people all the time. It's who you work with, what they're working on, who you're building it for. We're going to talk a lot about users throughout all this course because being a PM means being in tune with what your users are doing and what they want and what they're failing with and what the problems they have. It's very much thinking in terms, it's like a very empathetic position. And if you're not interested in being empathetic, both on like a, you know, solving business problem and just like an emotional level of like, how do people respond to what you're building? I like it. I like that's one of my favorite parts about being a PM is you get to focus on people all the time. This kind of sounds weird, but I like being wrong. Going back to that Netflix example, I remember the very first time I went into that UX lab and I got to watch someone use my product and I had built this really cool thing. So I remember it was the first time I ever shipped Redux, which is probably has nothing to do with this course. It's just something that stands out to me. And I was so excited about the technology that I had used to build this. And it was this like really cool experience. And I had this anticipation of like they're going to do this, then this, then this, then this. And I watched them and the person clicked on it. And then it was like, what is this? Like, I don't understand what you want me to do next. Like, and it was very unclear to this person. And I realized I was so focused on the technology of how I built this and like all of the cool things and like the blog posts that I could put on the tech blog about this, the conference talks I could give about it, because objectively it was very cool technology. I had missed the entire damn point, which is like people are going to go use this, right? And so when I saw them using it, I was like, oh my God, I'm so wrong. And that is so cool, right? Like I kind of felt like this, right? Which is why I put this GIF in here. It's like you build this thing and you have some anticipation of how people are going to use it. And then when it's actually given to someone, they use it some entirely different way. So some of you might've seen this picture before. This is called the desire path, right? You build this sidewalk here and you have this anticipation of people are going to go do this. And then people always find is like, I actually just want to solve my problem. Right? I don't want to go through your cool wizard. I don't want to go through your process that you set up for me. It's like, I have an intent when I arrive on your product and I want to achieve my intent as fast as possible. And you will discover these desire paths, right? It's not a term I made up. It's a term that actually exists. And people will, you know, carve that through your product either intentionally or unintentionally. And it's your job as a PM to recognize immediately, like, I'm wrong. I did this incorrectly. I was not in tune enough, or my bet or my experiment didn't work. And now, like if you're a PM, you would go pave this, right? Because now you have a concrete, it's like people actually just want to go here. Why do we use graphs? Why do we put graphs in anything? A lot of people put in graphs as what we talked about earlier, which is like to show their work. It's like, look at these numbers. I don't care about your numbers. I don't even care about, like, contextually, showing me numbers does nothing for me. So don't just show me a graph just to show me a graph. Graphs are for storytelling. They are tools of storytelling. Numbers themselves are not useful to show off. We use them to describe changes and to identify needs, right? So if you show me a graph, you better have a sentence underneath it, or you're about to tell me, is like, here is our signup, you know, graph of people signing up over time. It's in a line graph over time. And there's a dip here. Let's talk about the dip, or let's talk about why this shot up, right? And you're using that as a tool to tell me something about it. Okay? So given that, you want to have a graph that shows me your story. This is why pie charts are terrible, is because they're awful at telling stories. In other words, they basically don't tell stories. So I put a little graphic here. This came from the extreme presentation method. There's lots of things out there. It's like, what do you want to talk about? And so, like, do you want to show relationships? Do you want to show distributions? Do you want to show composition? Do you want to show comparisons? And then, there's a bit of a selection chart here. So comparison. You want to show it over time, and you want to show few periods, then a column chart would be good for single a few categories, or a line chart would be good for many categories, right? And this, I actually went through this and I was like, this is actually a pretty good selection methodology here. Generally, when I have numbers that I want to show in a graph, either I'll ask my data scientist, because to them it's obvious which one you choose, or I'll just Google, it's like, I have this kind of data, what kind of chart should I use? That'll help. And actually Tableau, if you've ever used the Tableau software, and I know that that's somewhat a competitor to what the thing that I work on now, it's actually fairly good at generally suggesting, like, you have data that looks like this, you might consider these kind of charts. That also helps as well. So tell a story with a graph, and then choose the right graph to highlight whatever story you're telling. Like a good one that I had to show recently was cost, like the, I was showing the COGS, and I can't remember what COGS stands for, cost of goods
sold.
Thank you. Which is basically like, how much does it cost to run my service? And we had one part of our spend that was ballooning, right? So I showed it in a stacked bar chart. So basically you could see over time that like the spending was staying the same. And if you were just looking at the total cost, our total COGS for my entire product, it looked like we were flat and like, good job, because we were growing users but not growing costs. But we actually saw that our costs were going down because we had done a lot of good infrastructure work. But we had one part of our service that was ballooning at such a rate that it looked like it was flat, right? And so I was trying to say, it looks like we're doing a good job. We're actually doing an awful job. Some parts of them are doing a good job at other things, but a stacked bar chart told that story really, really well, because you could see everything else shrinking and that one part growing.